Welcome to the 23rd episode of Comic DNA, on which we will be discussing Fear Agent by Rick Remender and Tony Moore with Jerome Opina and Francisco Francavala. First published by Image Comics in 2005. I am Aaron Walther, and with me as always is my good friend Luke Thompson Morris.
Thank you very much.
And for today's episode, we have a special guest, my good friend Josh Blasingame. Josh, thank you for being on the show.
Thanks for having me.
So, Josh is the co-creator and co-writer of Time Agent Z, which is a comic that he and I publish in my science fiction anthology, Science Hero, which is available on my website. And as of a few weeks ago, Comixology. So you can find Science Hero on Comixology. So, that's our little intro plug that we're getting out of the way here. So, we're going to talk about Fear Agent. Fear Agent is created and written by Rick Remender, who is probably known to many of the current comic book readers for all the various Marvel stuff he's been doing lately. I know he was writing one of their big crossovers, and he's written a number of their books. Like, I think he was doing some Punisher books, and he restarted the Uncanny X-Force, I think, a few years ago. So he's kind of like become a pretty big guy at Marvel right now, but back in 2005, he was just hitting it big on small press, or in the small press, with various creator-owned books he was doing for Image and Dark Horse. And the first four issues of Fear Agent, I think it's the first four, I would have to double-check. And I'm not going to. The first four issues are illustrated by co-creator Tony Moore, who is also a creator, an artist that is probably known to many comic book creators, comic readers. Moore co-created a little indie series at Image called The Walking Dead. Luke, have you heard of it?
No.
No?
What is it about?
It's about zombies, mostly.
Sounds pretty awesome.
Yeah. So, yeah, he did that with Robert Kirkman, and he drew a few issues of that and then moved on to some other co-creator series, and he's done some pretty high-profile work for Marvel, like Punisher and Deadpool and Ghost Rider and stuff like that. So, as I said in the introduction, we are here to discuss Fear Agent, which I would describe it as a science fiction throwback to classic pulp comics of the 50s. Actually, in the afterword to the first issue, Rick Remender specifically mentions Wally Wood as being a direct influence on Fear Agent. And if it really shows. If you're familiar with Wally Wood, like the designs and the visual style of Fear Agent are an overt homage to the work that Wally Wood did for EC Comics, like the old, like there was a variety of stuff that he did, but a lot of his sci-fi stuff was through EC, and like Wally Wood also did stuff for Mad before it became Mad Magazine back when it was comics. Okay. And he's Wally Wood is like he's a huge name. He's a huge influential creator of that time period. And so, Image Comics published the first 11 issues of Fear Agent. And after the 11th issue, the series moved over to Dark Horse, where it went on for about 20-some-odd more issues before finishing. For this podcast, we are just reading the 11 issues that was first published by Image. Luke, I already mentioned that Fear Agent is a throwback pulp science fiction comic, but I'm curious if you can summarize the plot into a simple synopsis.
Okay. Would say that the plot synopsis would go as such.
Spoilers?
Yeah, spoiler alert. The plot synopsis will contain spoilers. An intergalactic alien hunter is hunting an alien.
Good and, job.
Yeah, there we go. There it is. And finds himself accidentally thrown back in time and realizes he is presented with an opportunity to stop a gigantic genocide that his family was a part of.
Yeah.
And tries to take the steps necessary to do such.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, that sounds so much more concise than the way it actually reads in the comic.
Yeah,
yeah.
So there's a lot of very specific things that synopsis does not cover.
Right, exactly. So Fear Agent is an interesting little book. Josh, you and I were both reading it when it was coming out.
When it first came out. Yeah, I picked it up, flipped through it, and was really drawn into it. Really liked it.
Oh, I mean, I saw the... I think... I can't remember if I, like, saw a previews for it, but, I mean, I was hooked from the first issue. Like,
right.
Like, I was a huge fan. I mean, I liked... I think I had read something else by Rick Remender at that point, but he was still pretty...
new.
Like, he wasn't working on a lot of main, like, Marvel stuff at this point.
Still more underground.
Yeah, he was a little bit more underground. But, I mean, I was a big Image reader, you know, so I was reading a lot of various stuff. But, anyway, I also am a huge fan of Tony Moore. His artwork is just amazing.
Yeah.
And so I was totally hooked into this book. Like, classic EC Comics science fiction, you know, drawn by Tony Moore. Like, that's all I need to know. And I totally will buy this book. And I think that... we'll get into this discussion probably a little bit later, but I think it's really interesting for me to look at Fear Agent now, like with a retrospective look. This is the first time I've read it since I was reading it as it came out.
I did the same thing.
Yeah, this was the first time I've read it all in one sitting. And it's really interesting to kind of look at it with that hindsight of...
that newness is worn off?
Well, the newness... Yeah, that's it. The newness is worn off, but also kind of studying it as... like an example of how serialized fiction can like change and alter,
derail.
And I mean, derail is a perfectly acceptable way to put it. And I'm not even talking about like the quality of the book, but it's really interesting. I'm just gonna set that down. I'm gonna go ahead and pull out. I got the first issue here. It's really interesting, as I said in the afterword of the first issue. Or as I said, about the afterword in the first issue, Rick Remender, you know, he talks a little bit about what to expect in this book and like what they want to do. And he mentions the plan for this book is that there's actually two artists which are called co-creators.
Mm-hmm.
There's Tony Moore, and there's also a fellow by the name of Corey Walker. Now, Corey Walker, I know you two aren't familiar with Corey Walker. Corey Walker, he's a great artist. He was the co-creator of Invincible with Robert Kirkman.
Nice.
Okay.
Yeah. And Walker has done... He's done a handful of stuff in the industry, but he's not as prolific as, like, Tony Moore. Like, yeah. At the time, he was getting a lot of regular work, but he hasn't done as much, like, comic work lately. Maybe in the last, like, 5 years. I'm not 100% sure on that. I just don't see any books by him anymore. But anyway, the point is...
he made the comic book money and got out of the business.
Yeah, right. I mean, he's certainly a good enough artist to do that if I thought there was any money in the comic book industry. But as I was saying, Remender actually explains how there's two artists, and they're both called co-creators, Tony Moore and Corey Walker. And the plan, stated in the first issue, is that every 5 issues, they're going to tell a different chapter of Heath's life. So the plan is 5-issue story drawn by Tony Moore about, like, a chapter of Heath's life. Then they're going to do a 5-issue series drawn by Corey Walker telling a chapter of Heath's life. And they're going to switch back to Tony Moore. And then they'll switch back to Corey Walker and just kind of keep rotating like that. Well, if you've read the series, like we all have...
It doesn't last 5 issues.
It doesn't go down like that at all.
No.
First of all, Corey Walker never draws a single issue of Fear Agent. And by the 4th issue, Tony Moore is already going out the door.
Yeah.
He's basically gone. He's still credited as the as an interior artist, but at that point the new artist who's taking over the series, Jerome Opina, is sort of like he's credited as like finishing an additional interior art. And I think at that point they completely abandoned the stated plan of doing 5-issue story arcs and alternating between artists.
I mean, you can really tell, like, the first 4 issues are very cohesive.
Yes.
They flow together, they work really well, it's a good story. They're, of all of them, they're my favorite.
Me too.
That's what hooked me to begin with.
Mm-hmm.
Issue 5, they do it definitely is when you can see the train cars start to decouple as it's speeding down the broken bridge tracks.
It feels like a bunch of last-minute decisions had to be made.
Yeah.
And the story just really kind of rockets off.
Well, even if it even feels like a different writer.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Which is, I don't know, like I said, it's just interesting. Because, like, it's a good book. Like, it's an entertaining book. But, it did strike me, like, how, like, on upon rereading it, it did strike me, like, how it feels like the story completely got away from Rick Remender.
Right.
And it sort of starts to feel like this is going to sound like an insult, and I don't necessarily mean it as an insult, even though I would personally find it insulting if somebody said it about
criticism?
Me. No. It sort of starts to
isn't
feel
that what
like...
they call it? You know.
Yeah. It sort of starts to feel like TV show writing, specifically like the show Lost.
Yes.
Where it's just sort of like... everything is just sort of like being come up with at the last minute, and they're just putting a bunch of red herrings everywhere, and it's all like... all the drama in the single issue is like focused on some small story there, but then there's just a bunch of seemingly random cliffhangers and just random things added in to just sort of make it seem really dramatic. And it doesn't really make any sense or come together in any way.
It feels like, you know, having reread it, it reminds me of like more of the initial Marvel movies when they started.
Mm-hmm.
Mainly like Spider-Man 3. There's just so much going on. It's so dense. There's so much going on to where it's really hard. The flow is not there.
Mm-hmm.
They lost the flow. And it also seems like they had a lot of ideas and they weren't sure if, you know, Dark Horse can pick them up.
Right.
So quickly, let's just shove them all on these 11 episodes. And if it doesn't, we told our story. And it doesn't flow.
It doesn't work. It gets really weird. So
I noticed, you know, with the first four issues, like we've been saying, like, they were not scared to throw in as many plot twists as they possibly could.
Right, yeah. I mean, there were...
and it was kind of overwhelming, because, you know, you guys have read it before. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to, like, flip back to the pages and go, where did this come from? This is a little weird.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, now that Josh and I have totally been dogging this book, Luke, what were your first impressions as somebody who had never read it before? That's fine.
It was initially kind of overwhelming. Mm-hmm. Like, the first issue does such an interesting thing of dropping you in the dead center of everything happening without giving you any background, mm-hmm. any... you know, it just throwing a bunch of terminology at you, and I still, even after it being kind of overwhelming, I didn't really feel lost. You know, mm-hmm. I felt like I kind of knew what was going on. Mm-hmm. I picked up that, okay, he's hunting aliens. I don't know why yet, but he's hunting aliens. He happens to be on a job right now, and the first issue really hooked me in because it was a bunch of gratuitous action shots.
Oh, yeah.
That was really awesome.
I mean, we should say that the first issue is amazing. Like, it's an amazing first issue.
So,
I really like it.
Yeah.
Like, and Remender, even, I'm just going to keep referring to this afterward because I find it so interesting the way, like, Remender talks about the series in the first issue compared to what the series became.
Right.
Because he mentions that the first issue is basically, like, the first opening scene in Indiana Jones, where it's just, like, just an unrelated action scene just to sort of get you used to the character and get you all hyped up.
Right, right.
And then they move on to the proper story.
Certain stories can do that.
Exactly. Yeah.
Look at A New Hope. They jumped you right in the middle of this galactic battle.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? I feel like this issue did a really good job of, like, desensitizing us as, like, don't worry about all this crazy stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
Just, it's normal.
Right. It kind of makes sense.
Yeah.
It was in the story. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Did a really good job of setting up the setting, you know, just the mood. The
and our character. It definitely set up Heath very well.
I do really like Heath.
Yes. And I think...
I love how he's written.
So let's go ahead and talk about that. I think, Josh and I both have our criticisms of the book. And to be fair, I actually stopped buying Fear Agent after it switched over to Dark Horse.
I did as well.
Yeah, I bought, like, because when they switched to Dark Horse, they switched the format into... I actually don't think this was a bad idea, but they switched the format into more concise, like, 5-issue arcs.
Like they originally planned.
Yeah, exactly. So, it was... but they like, renumbered it. They were doing, like, what it is called the Hellboy BPRD numbering system, where each issue... they were just selling it as a series of mini-series. Even though it was a monthly book, each story arc had its own numbering. So it would be, you know, part 1 of 5, part 2 of 5, part... anyway. And then when the new series would start, it would restart with part 1 of 5.
Right.
But then at a certain point, they just went back to the original numbering just to keep it going.
Yeah.
But I think I bought the first two, maybe like up to issue like 21 or something to that effect. And I did stop buying it because it just, like, for all the reasons I just said, like, I feel like it kind of got away from what it originally was. But What was I just talking about?
We were going to talk about...
Okay. So, Heath. That's what I was going to say. So, I did stop buying the book because I feel like, and for all the reasons we just said, it felt like it got really derailed from its story. But the main character, Heath Huston, the Last Fear Agent, he is a great character. And I think he's a great character to, like, build classic science fiction pulp around. Like, he... Right. I mean, he is basically just filling that role of that character. Like, that 50s gritty sci-fi action hero. And I think he's a good character. And that's definitely... I want to say that's the biggest reason the book kept going even as long as it did.
Oh,
was because he's a really good character. And it's easy to see why readers would latch onto him and just want to keep reading about him, even if the story didn't make any sense.
Right. He's got Han Solo-esque qualities to him. He's more of a rebel, renegade.
He's a rogue.
You know, also kind of a good old boy.
Hey, Southern. He's from Texas.
Yeah. You know, and it's a really, you know, very Buck Rogers. The whole theme of the book, or at least the first couple issues, sets up in the style of, like, the 1960s future with the big bubble helmets and the old-style rocket, which I don't think there's enough of that today. I really like that style.
Agree. And that's the Wally Wood style I was talking about.
Right. Like, that totally is...
Right. For those of us who didn't know the EA or...
Yeah, the EC Comics.
Comics, right.
Right.
The old, like, Buck Rogers. So it really had that feel. And Heath Huston really felt like he could be part of even that. And actually, you know, coming up with Time Agency, I drew some of, you know,
we talked about it. When we did Time Agency, we actually took a lot from Fear Agent. I'm not ashamed to say it. When we talked to our first artist who was doing the design work, not Joey, who is drawing the book, Joey Simmons is drawing the book, but Christopher Tupa did the first design.
He was really good.
I'm a big fan of Christopher Tupa's work. But we actually sent him some Fear Agent picks, and we're like, we just wanted to have like an old, you know, old sci-fi, classic, whatever.
Between Fear Agent and, like, Tron.
We wanted to, like, bring in, like, it was, like, Fear Agent, Tron, and, like, some Star Trek. Just so, like, the sleekness of Star Trek. So, not too pulpy, but...
Right.
And so, like, you know, we came up with what we came up with. But, yeah, Fear Agent was actually one of the direct influences. Like, we gave him pictures of Heath Huston.
Huston. I keep saying Huston.
Huston.
Is it Huston? Is it Heath Huston?
I always read it Heath Huston. Then again, my brain fills in words sometimes.
Yeah.
Well, see, that's clever, too, because while this is still recording, if it's Huston, they even say, you know, Huston, we have a problem. And it's that
Huston.
Yeah.
There's no O. It's just H-U-S-T-O-N.
Oh, unfortunately.
I mean, Huston, he's from Texas. That would make sense.
My mind made that association, and anytime I saw that, I saw Huston.
That's Heath Huston.
But it was a direct influence on us. Like I said, we sent pictures of Heath Huston to Chris.
Christopher. I really like the character, and the first four issues are really about him, and, you know, the story for, you know, we've talked a lot about the first four issues, so I guess I'll do a little bit more detailed synopsis.
Well, yeah, we can kind of get into where the story goes. So, like we said, the first issue starts, it's just sort of just like a...
he's on a job.
He's an alien exterminator. Right. Like, he's essentially like it's like a bounty hunter, except people call him whenever they need some kind of, like, dangerous alien killed. Right. So, like, the first issue is...
No disintegrations.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So the first issue,
apes are attacking this town.
Yeah, it's like, well, it's like a planet, like, there's, like, a new settlement, like, pilgrims on the planet, and the indigenous life forms who are, like, a class D intelligence, which means that you're allowed to kill them because they're basically, like, subhuman or something to that effect. They're attacking the town, so they hire the Last Fear Agent, Heath Huston, to go, you know, take care of them, get them to stop.
Right.
And, you know, that basically just, like, it just ends. It's a one-issue story, and then at the end of that issue, he gets the call to the bigger story that's going to set up for the main story arc, which
check out the space station.
Yeah, check out the space station. And that's what issue two, three, and four. Well, actually, I think it's just issue two. Issue two is mostly just that, because we mentioned the time traveling thing, because that comes in issue three.
Yeah,
so that does come in really early. Because issue two, basically, he goes to the space station and sees that it's been wiped out. There's this alien creature, it's called Feeders, and they've infested the station. They just killed everybody.
Tentacle-eating monsters.
Yeah, space monsters. Just classic sci-fi monster, right. Alien monster. And so he can't fight them all, so he's going to leave because it's dangerous. Feeders are dangerous. And they kind of get into a little bit of his past.
A little bit of background.
That's where the Dressite aliens come in.
Yes.
Because they
attacked Earth in his backstory.
There's mentions to his backstory. We're never shown anything. But essentially, at some point in the past, Earth was attacked by these Dressite aliens. And they, killed a bunch of people, wiped out a bunch of people. And his son and his dad were wiped out, were killed in, the invasion.
Well, it's implied he's lost family members.
It's implied that he's lost family members.
We don't find out it's his dad and
his son. Yeah, he just says, he lost his family.
Right.
Yeah, that's...
I mean, they make notes about his wife. They constantly talk about Char.
Right,
and
his
then
wife.
He makes mention of how he always sees that look in his son's eyes. So, it tells us early that he's got a son.
Well, I think he's got that picture, up picture of his wife. Or of his ex-wife. Past wife.
Yeah.
But, so basically he's a troubled character. You know, he's had his family wiped out by an alien invasion, and now he jets around space in an old-fashioned rocket and kills aliens. You know.
Numbs his pain with whiskey.
And he's an alcoholic. We didn't really talk about that, when we were talking about the character, which I think is a good character trait. And, Remender was conscious of portraying Heath as an alcoholic and not just being, not being like Popeye, where he's like where it's like fun that he's an alcoholic, where he
powers up when he drinks.
I don't remember Popeye being an alcoholic. Unless I misunderstood the word spinach.
I think
forever.
Yes. Yeah, it wasn't spinach in the can; it actually was whiskey.
The spinach. It's a
that
metaphor.
Is some thick green whiskey.
But it's like with Huston. You know, he's an alcoholic, and he gets sloppy when he's drunk, and it's. That's part of his character. It's
right.
It's like equal parts like good old boy charm, he's a big drinker. But then there are also points in the story where it's like him being an alcoholic impairs him. So
his ship constantly tries.
The AI on the ship is always coming down on him about drinking too much and stuff like that. So
he even calls it his medicine.
So it's handled really well, but. We get these little bits of his backstory, these alien beings called the Dressites, who are like little amoebas who are in big body suits.
Kind of like Daleks.
Similar, yeah.
But different style.
But different, totally different style. Because they have more of a humanoid body suit.
Right.
But
four legs. And
yeah, they have four legs.
Arms.
Something to that effect. Yeah. But, they, the basic plot is they set the feeders loose on the space station so that they would kill everybody and multiply into lots of feeders, and then they were going to load all the feeders up into all the convoy, the cargo ships at the space station, and send them to Earth, and then the feeders would land on Earth and just wipe out all life on planet Earth.
Right.
That was their plan. And so Heath figures it out, and he's like, all the ships leave for Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's like, we got to get to Earth first.
He also finds the second character.
Mara, the second main character. Yeah, she's the only survivor on the space station.
Quantum physicist, scientist, I think.
Yeah, she's a scientist.
Was. Yes.
Mara is... She's a tricky character for me. Because she... When we talk about, when we were talking earlier about how it feels like a lot of things are changing as the story is being written. Mara feels
her
like a character
development.
Her character development feels like it's all over the place. Like, it feels like at one point in the story she was supposed to go this direction, but then they changed it to go this direction, but then they changed it to go a different direction.
Right.
It's hard to get a bead on what type of character she's supposed to be.
So, at one point, when you first meet her, she's very shy, stand up, smart, independent, strong woman.
Yeah.
Smacks him a lot of times.
Yeah.
Ignores his advances. Then she really goes to the damsel in distress.
Mm-hmm.
Then to, they have a makeout scene.
Yeah, yeah.
Sex scene. And then
A jilted lover.
Then jilted lover. Yeah. And then, mastermind behind it all.
Yeah.
It's weird. All in those 11 issues.
All in 11 issues, yeah. 10 issues, really. Because the 11th issue is just a one-off that has nothing to do with the main story.
True.
Yeah. So,
but it's still like... That's a lot to handle in a short amount of time.
Yeah. Yeah. So, basically, like, up, like, so this is, like, 2 issues in, like, Heath discovers the plot.
Right.
I'm like, still totally on board
with
this.
Right,
right. And, so the cargo ships are going to Earth, and he's like, we gotta get to Earth first, and my ship's faster, and we loaded up with
so
fuel
at space station. So they take a bunch of fuel, but the Driznites sabotage the fuel.
Right.
So they blast off, and they wound up going back in time, Star Trek style. Flying so fast.
Yeah.
Which, the first time I read it, I did not catch that, I'll be honest. So when I came to the third issue, I was so confused, like, what the hell is happening?
Well, the thing is, it wasn't explicitly stated.
No,
like,
it was not.
It was supposed to be, like, a reveal, like a surprise, like, dun-dun-dun reveal.
Right.
Because the whole thing is, they're on the planet, and they're talking about the robot species.
So that's basically...
So now we're on issue 3.
Yeah, like, I mean, it felt really tense whenever they were going back in time, like... And he was trying to walk them through it, you know, like, something's going wrong, they sabotage fuel, blah, blah, blah. So, like, I got, like, hints of that's what was going to happen.
Right, because at the end, I don't know if that's the end of the second issue or the beginning of the third, the ship comes out of hyperspace.
Beginning of the third.
Yeah.
They, you know, they're knocked unconscious, Annie's breaking up, they crash land, ship explodes.
That seems kind of heartbreaking for me, because I really liked the whole AI dynamic.
Yeah. Right, right. You know, you've known 3 characters, they already killed off one.
Yeah.
Right.
And they're not done.
Yes.
Spoilers!
No, they're not. Anyone viewing this podcast, be wary. We are going to spoil the book that we're talking about.
It is a book from 10 years ago. I think the statute of limitations ran out on spoiling this book.
I guess. I don't know.
This is how we do it in this podcast.
Is it?
Yes.
I'm still learning.
So, but yeah, so they, like, end up back in time, and that's when they meet the robot species, the Titalians.
Yeah, they land on this planet, and there's, like, these...
It's like a destroyed post-apocalyptic city. Yeah,
right.
Right. And there's all these, like, rabid robots.
Classic 1960s robots with brains in jars on top of them.
Yeah.
Which I love.
That was great.
So much.
No, it was cool. Yeah, it was really cool.
And then, yeah, a big battle ensues. They're trying to figure out what the hell's going on, and they blast off, and Heath gets shot. And you found out, there's another race of these, basically, green snow yetis who...
Yeah.
Have been fighting the aliens. And
the robots.
The robots.
Have been fighting the robots.
Right.
Yeah. So, like, issue three ends with Heath getting shot through the midsection by, like, a giant harpoon.
Right.
And, like, this sort of begins the series of Heath, like, dying, like, at the end of every issue.
Yeah, once I got to the... Because we've already spoiled that he dies more than once. Once it happened the second time, I was like... You guys really aren't afraid to kill your main character, are you?
Right.
Well, or, like, potentially kill.
I was going to say, it becomes a problem, because it's not that he dies. We're saying he's dying, but what's happening is, every issue ends with it looking like he's going to die, and then something happens where he doesn't die.
The next issue starts up.
Yeah, exactly.
They did the same thing, though, with the original Batman series.
Oh, sure.
You know. But it was just... I don't know, it doesn't work... As well.
I feel like you just lose the impact of death as a storytelling device when it happens so much.
Right.
Yeah.
They hit it in a third, and then, you know, at the end of the fourth, he does basically die.
Beginning of
the fifth, he's got a new clone body. So, 5 issues into the series, your main character has died and already re-risen.
Right.
That is a bold statement in any book. And yes, it really takes away that suspense that they've built up. So, I think that was a really bad choice.
Yeah.
As far as writing, you know.
I didn't mind the whole, like, it. Like we said, Heath does die in issue 4 or 5.
I want to say it's beginning of 5.
I think
at the very end of 4.
At the end of 4 is where he dies.
The giant enemy robot leader
stomps on him. And, like,
yeah, and
crushes
it ends
him
with the big black panel.
Yeah. Right. And then in 5...
He throws him out, and he falls into the snow. And
then he gets
Founds the underwater jelly bones.
I thought the beginning of issue 5 of him falling in the water and getting rescued by the water, the jellyfish, up until he got rescued by the jellyfish, I felt like it would have been better at the end of issue 4 than starting the issue.
Because,
I mean, if they're going to end on a cliffhanger...
That's the whole thing, is... I don't really have a problem with, like, the story plot device of Heath getting killed and then them bringing him back, like, right. a clone. That's just pure sci-fi, you know, right. whatever. But it's, to me, it starts to get tiresome when it becomes, like, a suspense plot device. At the end of each issue, it looks like he's going to die. Come back next month to find out what happens. And it's, the thing about that is, I'm not even saying it was, like, I'm sure it was actually intentional, because that is such, like, a classic, like, old serial sci-fi thing. Mm-hmm. Like if you've ever seen, and I don't know why you would, but those old, like, World War II serials from, like, the 30s and the 40s of, like, the, just, like, the, like, Commander Cody and, like, Flash Gordon and stuff like that. And it's, like, it's, they're serials that they would play in front of movies. So they're just, like, 5 to 8 minutes long. At the end of each one, the hero would basically die, like, get shot or something would happen. And then the next one would start up and they're just, like, oh, we know you thought he died, but he was actually, like, he remembered to put on his bulletproof armor. So it didn't kill him, even though it looked like he died in the last
one. Sell tickets.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's that sort of, like, bait and switch constant suspense. Right. And that's what's purposely being done in these comics.
I understand that.
Yeah.
But with the theme of the first four,
mm-hmm.
it does not work.
I understand it, but I got tired of it. Like, yeah. I didn't really care.
For what this is going to be probably like our most critical podcast.
You know what? And it really is. And I guess I'll take this moment to say, like, you know, in doing this podcast, like, it really isn't my intention to give negative reviews. The intention is to have a discussion. And because when we read something, and then when we can discuss it, we learn more about it in talking about it. And we can learn to understand it as discussing it. And that was always my intention in doing this podcast. But another thing that I think is important to say that a lot of people really can't seem to wrap their minds around is that just because you like something doesn't mean you can't be critical of it.
That's
and just because you're critical of something doesn't mean you dislike it. Like, I like Fear Agent. Yeah. I'm telling you right now, I like this comic.
I feel like being critical of it makes it look like you like it more. Like, you're taking the time to...
Exactly. I'm taking the time to think about it and discuss it. And I think, I mean, I can't speak for Rick Remender or Tony Moore, but as and myself as a creator, that means way more to me if somebody right. can, like, read it and then talk and, like, discuss it and tell me why they dislike it.
Right.
Like, rather than just, like, a knee-jerk, like, you know...
Well, I didn't like it.
I didn't like it. It was stupid. Yeah, exactly. So, that is... I mean, you're right, Luke. This probably is going to be our most critical episode.
I think we needed it, though.
Well, yeah. We were getting a little soft. I was... Yeah. We were...
Got to get the hard-hitting truth out of
it. We were too busy... I was gonna say we were too busy brown nosing Joe Kelly and we did those two Joe Kelly books, I Kill Giants and the Deadpool. Yeah, we were too busy sucking up to Joe Kelly. So now it's time to really, really lay into Rick Remender, right. that successful son of a bitch.
Yeah.
Just kidding. So
if I did not like it, I wouldn't have, you know, used it to create Time Agency.
Exactly, you know? Yeah. And that's another thing, too. Like, things I really, really don't like, although I do think there is value in negative criticism and, like, reading something and understanding why it's not good. Things that I really dislike, I do not waste my time on. Nope. I'm not interested in talking about things that do not interest me. that's a fair point. This is going to be a pretty... This is coming... certainly ending up as being a really critical episode.
Rightfully so, though.
But, I mean, but for an important reason. With it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's... Yeah.
Me less so, because this is the first time I read it. Mm-hmm. I haven't had the time to find comb through it. You guys have.
right.
So...
But I do think that... I wonder how many people felt like the way, like, Josh and I did about the book. Because I know it had a pretty strong following, like, as it was going. And like I said, that for all the reasons we discussed, I'm not surprised by that. Heath is a great character.
Right.
I mean, it's a good looking book. Although I was very sad that Tony Moore left after four issues.
Yeah, I could tell that kind of like
that. The book really kind of started to feel different after
and
Tony
it happened
Moore left.
Right as when Heath died. So
exactly, it was
when
a
I got
weird
to issue five. I had to do like a double check several times to make sure like. Is this the right issue?
I felt like I skipped forward on accident.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. And like, it's a different style, and it doesn't quite match up to the very.
Well, I think I actually think Jerome Opeña.
He did well.
I think. Well, he's a great artist. Yeah. I actually think he's a really good artist. And I think he does a good fear agent. I do think he was trying to kind of mimic Tony Moore for a little while there.
Yeah.
And it just felt weird. Because it just, it was like, it wasn't Tony Moore. Like, it was very obviously not Tony Moore. Right. But it was, like, similar enough in style. I think he's a good...
Six or seven, it, like, I think he finds his stride.
Yeah.
Until, like, five was like, okay.
Yeah.
You know, he just kind of got, like, thrown in the deep end.
Yeah. And well, and like I said, I don't know what was going on behind the scenes, but as we previously established, by issue one, the plan was for Corey Walker to start on issue six.
Right.
So at some point, that changed, and they brought in Jerome Opeña. I don't know at what point the series they brought him in, because it was in issue four that he was brought in to kind of help Tony Moore catch up to the deadline. Because that is one thing. I am such a huge fan of Tony Moore, but he is not a punctual artist.
I've yet to really meet a very punctual artist.
Don't get me started on artists. I'm just kidding. I love you guys.
Are you ready to say that?
I have to say that, otherwise they won't work with me.
Yeah, there you go.
Jerks. But, Tony Moore, he is also, he's a guy. He's a guy. So I've been told. He's such a great artist, but like it seems to be like the trend is he'll start a book and he'll do four or five issues of it and then move on to something else. So like Walking Dead, I think he did maybe six or seven issues and then he moved on. And then he just kept doing covers for it, but then they brought in a new artist to do the interiors. Fear Agent, like 3.5 issues, and then he moved on.
Yeah.
He was doing a series called The Exterminators, which is another interesting series that I do really like. That's probably the most issues of a single series he's ever done. And that was like, he would do like little pockets. Like he did like 10, I think 10 issues straight, which was the most I think he's ever done in a row. And then like, then they had to have a fill-in artist, and then he would do a couple of more, and then there would be a couple of more fill-in artists. So he couldn't just do the series full stop straight. He did, when they relaunched the big Deadpool book a few years ago with Brian Posehn writing it, the stand-up comedian Brian Posehn, Tony Moore was the artist for that, and I think he maybe did five issues and then he moved on, and it's just like it almost becomes frustrating, and I think I've heard other comic fans complain about this. I am certain fanboys complain about this, actually.
Fanboys complain about everything,
so that's why I'm certain they complain about it. Which is that it's really frustrating, because like a new series will start with Tony Moore, and you love Tony Moore, and you want to see him draw the series, but you know he's only going to be in the first couple of issues, and then they're going to bring in like a second-rate artist to like finish it out. And that is not a slam on like Jerome Opeña or any other artists who are taking over for him. Because, honestly, most of these guys that are getting professional work, they're great artists. But when it comes to art, you know, style is everything. Not everything, but it's a huge selling point to a lot of...
I mean,
a lot of these books.
Comic book.
It's a comic book, yeah.
If there was no artist, it would just be a book.
It would be a book. Well, I guess what I mean is the selling point is the specific artist and his style, like in this case, Tony Moore. And like, I would love to read more comics by Tony Moore. Like, if he drew every issue of Fear Agent, that would be amazing. But, you know, it just didn't happen. I don't know if he just can't keep that kind of schedule or if it's just more lucrative for him. I mean, knowing the little bit that I do about the industry, I imagine it's a combination of not keeping the schedule, because drawing comics is a tremendous amount of work. And for very little pay, and you can actually make it's a better payoff versus with time management if you're just doing covers, because you can put in so much money for a cover, you can get paid a little bit more than a standard issue page to do a cover, and you can do like multiple covers in a month, so you can this is total made up math, but I'm just hypothesizing that you could do like 10 covers in a month and make more money than you would drawing 22 pages of a comic in a month. I don't know. Any comic book artists out there want to correct me, feel free. But that's just my loose, made-up mathematical...
Nope, we have a caller in line.
Oh my god!
To dispute that fact.
Is that math real?
It's Jack Kirby from Beyond the Grave, and he says that all the artists working today are
bullshit.
Lazy shits. Jack Kirby would draw like 50 pages in a week. Like seriously, he drew Captain America 1 like over a weekend.
Yeah.
It's like a 30-page comic.
That's astounding.
Well, that's not true. because it was Jack Kirby and Joe Simon. But still Jack Kirby drew the majority of it. Yeah. So anyway.
Back to Time Agency. Fear Agents.
Back to Time Agency. This comic that you should be reading because it's even better than Fear Agents. Yeah, right. I can't even say that with a straight face. So, back to Fear Agents. What were we talking about?
He went off on that tangent.
I went off on a crazy tangent there.
I popped in and out.
Yeah. So basically, like, the time travel comes in issue 3. It was a little hard to follow.
Time travel comes in issue 3, and then at the end of, like, there's a big war.
Yeah, you find out
that this is thousands of years, and that these robots will attack Earth.
Yeah, the robots are the ones that go on to destroy Earth, which I thought kind of, like, that's where you start, like, the plots, like.
Like, this you thought it was the Dresdenites?
This is where my main issue with the storytelling is, because it feels like it keeps changing.
Yeah.
Like, at first it was the Dresdenites. They're the ones that destroyed Earth.
They just keep, like you said, they keep throwing you red herrings.
Yeah. And then in this, the issue where they're back in time and they're like, oh, the Totalians, they're the ones that destroyed Earth. And you're like, what? I thought it was the Dresdenites.
Yeah. Right. But they do mention one other battle that they talk about, you know, having to wipe out the whole planet because the feeders got in there.
Exactly.
But, you know, Huston does say he killed thousands of the Dresdenites, so maybe he fought in that conflict to protect Earth, but eventually fell.
Yeah.
The robots, they don't give you a lot of information, and they change things quickly. Like Lost, which I hated.
Exactly.
I hated Lost.
I am on record as not.
Do not give me on a tangent on J.J. Abrams.
We are new Star Wars. We are not opening that can of worms.
I am
at
a huge
all.
Star Wars fan. And
We're not even going there. So
happy thoughts.
So that's where I think a lot of the story started to feel really frustrating, because the information would sort of like come out of nowhere, and then it would seem to change, and then there would be like something that sort of like tied it all back together. Like, for the record, the issues, the story arc that they did after they left Image, the first one they did for Dark Horse, was like 100% the origin of Heath and the war that wiped out the people on Earth. They totally did that story, and I mean, that's, you know, technically that's issue 12, so I don't think it's like they waited forever to get around to telling it, but it doesn't flow with the rest of the story. It doesn't flow. That's the thing. It's like, it doesn't flow, and it's kind of weird. So they've got the robot war, like, they...
And it turns out, like, there's a, you know...
Mm-hmm.
Because the Green Yetis become so advanced, they want to live forever, so they put their minds in the robot bodies. And then you have the divide.
Ones...
So it's a civil war.
It's a civil war between the ones who became robots and the ones who didn't become robots.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
And that's like a full issue based on that. And that's all fine.
That's fine.
Like, actually, I like the story that they set up here. So basically, like, as you said, Luke, in the original plot synopsis at the beginning of this episode, basically the drama here is that Heath is back in time, and he apparently has the opportunity to prevent this robot race of eventually destroying Earth and killing all his family. Like,
which is a big...
That's a moral dilemma,
you know?
So...
What would appear to be one of the driving forces behind the main character.
Exactly.
Well, again, that's a thing that we'll get into a little later in a later episode.
Right. So, he decides he's going to do it. Like, it's no question for him. Like, I'm going to kill all these robots and save everybody on Earth. That's what I have to do. It's, you know, it's my duty.
Right.
And he basically does it.
He makes an attempt, and it's a trap. One of them got betrayed.
He
and
knew
gets
the
killed.
Whole, the boss knew the whole time.
Yeah, like more just sort of like plot twist upon plot twist upon
right.
plot twist. Like, so then
giant robot steps on him. He goes squish.
Kills him. Yeah, and then you have the jellyfish brains.
He falls into the water underneath this ice planet city. You have these weird jelly brains,
right.
Half brain, half jellyfish.
And that issue, I think that's where it started to feel weird. Because that
started to.
But well, no, I mean with the plot. That was the issue where it started to feel weird. Which was,
like we said, at the end of issue 4, he dies.
Yeah.
Or he gets stomped on. And then at the beginning of issue 5 is when he got rescued. So that's when I started to think it. Okay, what?
Yeah. Well, that is where it started to feel weird. That, like we said, that's where Tony Moore left the book. Issue 5 was the new artist, Jerome Opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And the jellyfish brain aliens, that alien appeared in the first issue in just like a a random, not random, but like seemingly not tied to continuity.
Right.
Like that was just the main bad guy alien. It was completely like a no-name alien. It was just there. It was the bad guy that Heath kills.
It turned out that brain alien was controlling the apes to attack the thing to build a rocket so he could leave.
Yeah, exactly.
And he kills them all.
Mm-hmm. And then in the issue 5 we see it's that brain alien from the first issue.
Oh, they gave him a new body.
And then it's like they're super intelligent, of course, because they're giant brains. And they clone him, and it just spent like a whole issue like arguing. Like,
yeah,
it was kind of a anticlimactic, uneventful issue.
It reminded me of the scene in episode 1 of Star Wars where Qui-Gon Jinn and Boss Nass were arguing and. That, but less entertaining than that, which is saying something.
I don't know if I'd go that far.
Okay,
that's pretty bad.
I will drag that statement.
I can't believe you would ever compare something.
Off the record.
I can't believe you would ever compare Phantom Menace to something in which Phantom Menace was the better of the two. That's just
Attack of the Clones.
We're not going down that road.
Anyway,
I can't believe you would ever use Phantom Menace as a positive example for any reason. That's all I'm saying.
I mean,
what not to do
positive.
In a movie?
Anyway. Yeah.
So yeah, like
it invoked that imagery.
Basically, they spend like a whole issue like arguing, and then Heath is finally able to convince the brain aliens that they
intervene.
He didn't convince them; they read his mind, and they go, "Oh, wow, he's right. Okay."
Well, that's like the whole thing. Like they read his mind, and the aliens like, "Oh, the brain is like, oh,
you
kill
me
in the future.
I'm gonna kill you.
I'm gonna kill you." And
then like his wife comes out. And
yeah.
Says, I've read it. He speaks the truth. He's like, "No,
the female brain."
It jokes that I guess she wore the pants in the relationship, and like the brains attack and wipe out the robots.
They wipe out the robots. The future is saved and completely changed. And like they put the time machine in the ship. And
well, they don't even get that far. He gets like the Yetis rebuild the ship, and then the robots want the ship to get off the world so they could spread and exterminate.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
and he gets on the ship, but Mara gets captured or killed.
Yeah, Mara gets.
There was someone jumped in the ship and killed her.
Right. And then he jumps before she could. You know, before he could stop or rescue her.
Actually, I don't think that's what happened. That was you know.
I actually want to know what happens here because I was really confused.
It was a little confusing in the art.
It's
what
it
happened was
jumps. Does the time jump.
The ship. He's on the ship.
Right.
He's on the outside of the ship because he has to hold the conductors together so that they get a charge or whatever, and so he's not going to die when he does it because it's grounded wire. But he's like he can't leave. Like he sees her being drug off the ship. And he's like, oh my god, you know, Mara, no. And then the ship travels into the future. They can only make one jump, and it travels into the present day, like 1,000 years or however many years, to the present day on this alien spaceship.
Right.
And that's when he falls off the ship. So he's in the future now. He's like 1,000 years in the future. And, like, civilization has completely changed. Like, these ape creatures are, like, super smart, civilized beings. They've got these
They're in society.
Yeah. And
made a comeback.
And there's all these different, they call them constables. There's all these constables flying around, and the constables are all clones of Heath and Mara.
Right.
Which confuses him, because he's like, what's going on here?
They made more of me. Yeah. How dare they?
Yeah, they made more of me.
Like,
and
dude, you're already a clone. What do you care?
And then he's like, yeah, exactly. Like, you're already a clone. But then it's like, that doesn't last long because then all of a sudden
that's
these.
That's like 2 pages.
It's like 2 pages and you're like, oh, okay, so he's in the future now. And then bam, like, oh, these like giant floating cities show up and they start wiping everything out.
Independence Day style.
Yeah, Independence Day style.
I mean, they just nuked whole planets. You're like,
yeah.
Damn. And it's like, and then you know, like. The last page of issue is, you know, he's under, you know, these ships around him, and, you know, put your hands up, you're under arrest for
crimes against time travel.
Right.
For time traveling, I think. It's like you're under arrest for time travel.
Time traveling and time paradoxes.
Yeah.
Like, okay.
Now, yeah, this is where it feels like it really goes off the rails, and I have no idea what it's.
We've left the ground and are currently sailing above the cliff.
Yeah.
Starting to nose down to the cliff. Below.
Yeah, so the next issue is basically Heath just on trial for changing the future.
Right.
And we get this big speech by this alien race. They're just called, like, Keepers.
The Keepers. Air.
Yeah. And it's their job to make sure everything happens the way it's supposed to happen, whatever. And Heath is upset because, you know,
they
undid all the things that he did. Right. So he's upset because now they're going to kill...
Those killer robots are back. Yeah. Leech is wiped out, or the jelly brain's wiped out. They've killed the other, quote-unquote, 13 issues of him, instances of him.
Yeah, I was kind of confused about that because part of me went, oh, okay, maybe they've done this event a bunch because the time travel. Right. Part of me goes, oh, maybe it's the clones. I don't know.
Right.
I got the impression it was alternate paradoxes, kind of like the end of
the Matrix. That was the initial impression I got. Yeah.
Or the reloaded, whatever.
Yeah.
Concordly, vis-a-vis.
Yeah, exactly.
The architect, that's what it was.
Yeah. I was under the impression that's what it was. They were rounding up all the different, like, paradox, alternate reality versions.
Multiverse.
Yeah, the multiverse versions. And they executed them all. Except for the Prime.
The Prime.
Which is who was on trial currently.
Which is who was on trial in this issue. And they sentenced him to a life in prison for the crimes.
But they don't do a good job of explaining that. They just, like, one or two...
It was another instance of them just throwing us in and expecting us to know, but it wasn't nearly as flawlessly executed as the first issue.
I agree.
The thing that's weird about it is this is where these issues, like, we're getting into, like, 6, 7, and 8 territory here.
Mm-hmm.
This is where, like, it stops feeling like pulp action.
Right.
You know what I mean? He's not rocketing around in a jetpack and shooting aliens with his laser gun anymore.
He's no longer Alien Exterminator. He's now, like...
Alien criminal
hero thing guy.
Yeah. So, and this is where I started to kind of feel weird about the book because like the setup was he's the last of the Fear Agents, which were this like group of elite warriors who like they don't really say what they did. They were just like this group that existed and he
that got
aliens.
Mentioned in the first book and then for like the big string of issues. Never even remotely talked about. Mara brought it up once, like, oh, you can't be a fear agent. That's it.
They lived years ago.
Yeah.
And that's the last
they lived years ago. Yeah, exactly. And it's kind of, they were sort of playing that whole, like, Jedi thing in Star Wars where it's like the Jedi. They used to do stuff a long time ago, but we don't really see them now. Oh, Obi-Wan Kenobi's a Jedi. You know?
Yeah.
And that's kind of what was going on, except, like, at this point, like, he's not hunting aliens anymore. Like he's not doing anything that was in the first issue.
The chief's gone. He's on trial.
Yeah. The girl died.
It's an episode of Law and Order.
Exactly. Yeah. The girl died. He's like trapped. He's like wrapped up in this weird continuity story, and so they sentence him to life in prison. And so then you just get this story of him, like the issue of him just like in prison. And he's like...
Well, that's when he starts to do some of the flashbacks.
Yeah, you start seeing some of the flashbacks to...
The day the attack happened.
Yeah, his dad and his son get killed in, like, this weird bomb attack. And that is something that always bothered me, even when I first read it, because... This is something that I was going to bring up. When the hell is this story taking place?
Don't know.
right. Okay? Because the flashbacks look like they're taking in, like, present-day 2005.
Right?
Which means that, like, all the stuff in the Fear Agent book, like, starting issue one, are, like, 10 years after that. Because the whole point of the Fear Agent thing, it's like 10 years ago he was a Fear Agent and, you know, in this big battle or whatever. So, you know, we're talking like, is it actually supposed to be like 2015? Is that supposed to be the year?
Right.
Because if it is, it's just really weird because like in the flashbacks, there's
He is younger. I mean...
No. What I mean is weird. What's weird about it to me is that in the flashbacks, like, it's just regular Earth. Like, there's no, like, no contact with aliens that we know of. Like, there's no, like... It's like...
Advanced technology or anything.
Yeah, exactly. It's just, like, everyday Earth. Then suddenly Mars attacks happens. And then 10 years later... It's like he's like flying around in a spaceship, completely acclimated to the universe, and there's like millions of races, and Earth is in the like the.
Right.
It feels a little weird. Like it's not like in Star Trek where there's like this big event, you know, about how like Earth got brought into the Federation and like society like changes drastically
over this length
of centuries. Right. Yeah,
that's a lot of info to happen in 10 years. That's
yeah, It just struck me because, like, when I read the first issue, I was like, oh, cool science fiction, just taking off in the far distant future. You know, that's just when it takes place. And, like, you know, he's got it. It's just Star Wars. I just read it as...
I expect to see flying cars and whatnot.
Yeah, I read Fear Agent as, like, basically like a Star Wars set. In a galaxy far, far away. It's just a future technology. So when Heath is talking about, like, oh, my family was killed, I just assume his family was killed... you know, 10 years ago, his time, which would be, like, the year 3005, you know?
Right.
And, like, when they do the flashback, and they're, like, playing, like, Toby Keith.
Yeah, and like, there's a guy like, comes in, like, you know, oh, Hank Williams. That's an old classic. We want some new modern stuff. They're playing Toby Keith. Like,
yeah. It just felt, like, so weird. I was, like...
And it's just, like, a normal bar, or, like, they've got a jukebox, and him and his dad were fixing just, like, an old pickup truck.
Yeah.
They drive, like, a 1930s like, a
pickup truck.
Right, right. And, you know, the kid gets caught in barbed wire as he's flying a normal kite, like...
Yeah.
You know, he's talking about, oh, dad's dying of cancer, like...
Yeah, there was...
Okay.
There was all this stuff,
normal
kind of, like,
person problem.
Right,
yeah,
right, right.
Yeah. It just, like... It didn't jive with what I had, like, You
maybe
only get
it does connect back to Mara saying, oh, you're, how can you still be the last one? Like, thousands of years. Maybe he did. Maybe, hibernation sickness or something, you know, lived.
But I don't know, because I think there was a specific thing basically saying, like, there was a 10-year difference between the events of the book present-day story and his past. So, like, he's been, because they do these backup stories called Tales of the Fear Agent. In the issues.
I just saw those like fanfics. I didn't think they were actually like...
Those were just supposed to be random stories. Did you read those, Luke?
Yeah.
Those were just supposed to be random stories that took place in the 10-year gap between him becoming a fear agent and like the current story.
Oh.
Yeah.
Kind of like his... Yeah. Yeah, just a little backstory.
Just little random adventures he went on. Yeah. So...
I just thought it was more random fanfic, but I guess that...
Well, I mean, Rick Remender didn't write them, but they were all written by, like, friends of his. But...
So, in theory, they were fanfic.
But they were paid to do it, I'm sure. Well, actually, I'm not sure.
Is fanfic paid?
No, fanfic's not paid.
No.
But, anyway, so, yeah, that's... I thought that was, like, when they did that, that's where it started to feel weird to me. Where I just, like, could not get a bead on, like, what this universe was supposed to be like. Right. Because, like, in the present day, it's just, like, intergalactic... truckers, you know, aliens of all kinds just all over the place, and then...
That's what hooked me.
Oh, yeah, I love... that was the style of the first issue.
That's exactly what I thought it was gonna be.
Yeah, and that's where I say it feels like the style of the book changed, like, halfway through, because in the first few issues, it feels like it's just Star Wars, not a galaxy not too far away, just, like, aliens everywhere, whatever, you know. Okay, they do talk about Earth, like, right. So he's from Earth, but that doesn't mean that it's not Earth in the future, you know what I mean?
Adventures of Duck Dodgers, 24th and a half century.
Exactly.
Crazy wackadoo.
Exactly. And that's the impression I get. And then all of a sudden, it's like sort of grounded in this time of like present day, and it just feels like weird to me. It just didn't jive with like the way I was reading the book before they dropped that information.
Right.
Yep.
And, so yeah, like, that's where I started to feel weird about the book. Up until this point, I was, like, giving these issues the time travel, you know, tribunal, like, trial.
But not, like, yeah, the, you know, time travel, cloning death, more time travel.
Yeah.
Alternate paradox, time trial.
Right.
All in 5 issues.
Yeah.
Like, that is a lot to take in.
Yeah.
Anytime you're going to introduce time travel, that's so tricky, because it's so easy to have it get messy. So fast.
Right.
Yeah, it is. And honestly, you know, the time travel stuff doesn't bother me. I think it's a fine story. It's a good device to use.
Right.
I really didn't even care about, like, him dying in, like, the clone body. Like, as just, like, a simple, like, explanation of, like, oh, here was a suspenseful thing that happened, and we're just gonna, like, totally get out of it because it's the future. So, you know, whatever. You know, that was all fine. Like I said, what really actually really got me was when they were like...
When they connected to
when
the
they were
reality.
Connecting it to reality, and that felt weird to me. And then, and I think that's the same issue then, so he's in prison and he gets addicted to this drug, like the space drug.
Yeah.
And like they have him in solitary, and then this is what really bothers me. This is what actually really bothers me. I don't know if you guys... I would like to know what you guys thought about this. So he takes the space drug off the space lobster and gets addicted to it and kills... Like, he kills the space lobster, so they put him in solitary. And then the dude, like, the keeper guys, they show up, and they're just like, oh, release him. We've changed our verdict. Let him go. Yeah. Why did that happen?
They said new evidence has come to light. During the whole trial, it was like, you gotta believe me, these robots, they
yeah, he was, other he was trying to say the Dressites sabotaged right. his ship what to I send did, him back in time.
Right.
Right?
Because they believed, from what I gathered, because it is not, you know,
it's not clear.
The prosecution is pushing that he did all of this to save his family and uh-huh. mess with time, which, you know, purposefully, which is a big no-no.
Yeah.
He's claiming it was a setup by the Dresdenites and that he was just trying to get back home to save, to stop this abomination, and you gotta believe me, Earth's in danger right now.
Yeah.
You know, there's thousands upon thousands of these feeders going there. You gotta let me out.
Right.
You know, guilty, they throw him out in jail.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I don't remember, there was something specific, like, they could have done really easily to... Mara shows up in the middle of trial.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
the other that's thing.
Right. Cause
Mara's
just there. Like, she just survived.
They call her as a witness, and she shows up, and they time travel, and they just get her. It's okay, sure. They grabbed her, the original or whatever.
Yeah.
She's a clone.
Well, because they were having to adjust all the things that got changed.
Right.
So they bring her back. They pull her back.
Right. Yeah. And she testifies, but they stick this device on her that says, you know, you have to tell the truth. If you lie, you'll get, like... electrocuted.
Right. What? How
they
did
couldn't
she
just do that to Heath and have him, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Oh, he is innocent. That this is machine that cannot lie.
Yeah.
Shows he's telling the truth.
That is like such a huge like. That is such a huge classic sci-fi plot hole of like
right.
we have a device that forces people to tell the truth, and we don't use it on the character
who needs to tell the truth
so we right. can figure out what's going on.
Right.
So yeah, that's why it just felt so weird.
Right.
Like it was odd. Yeah.
Right.
So then they're just like, oh, let him go. New evidence came.
New evidence has come to trial, and we just let him go. He's like, what evidence? I'm like, you'll find out.
Yeah, yeah. He wants to know what happened, and they're like, oh, we're not going to talk about it right now.
Right.
And then they just put him on a ship, and Mara's all like, you don't know what's going on. We got to get back to Earth really quick.
Right. And so like, he's in bad shape. They heal him.
Yeah.
And then the next issue
is like, oh, all the feeders are on Earth? Like, now. It's just like he was too late. So the
it ends like halfway through his... I forget if his flashback is part in the drug-induced coma or if it's part in the rehab coma. It sounds so much like a soap opera.
Issue 7 is the one where he's in jail.
Right.
And
judging by the cover.
Judging by the cover of the issue. I'm going to pull it open right now. Issue 7 is the one that ends with him being let out. Yeah. So they let him out, and Mara's like, we got to clean him up, and we got to go back.
He's our only hope.
He's our only hope. We got to get back to Earth. And they get going, and then they show the Dressites, like, following him.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're just right. like, oh, we're going to sneak up behind him and use his passcodes to get to Earth.
Right.
And it's just like, I just could not tell, like, what the point of that was.
Right.
Like, what? If they wanted to, like, follow him and use his passcodes to get to Earth, why didn't they do that the first time? Why did they throw him back in time so that he could go on this, like, suicide mission and try to change the future so that he could get arrested and then sent to prison so that he could get let out so that they could follow him to Earth? Why didn't they just follow him to Earth the first time he went? This is what I'm talking about when I talk about the plot being, like, crazy and off the rails.
Wow, when you say it like that, it makes so much sense.
Because if you think about it, it doesn't make any sense. If you're reading it as a monthly comic, though, it's just, like, constant suspense and just constant action and just constant...
Because you forget all about that.
Exactly, you forget all about
that. They might as well just put it at the end of the issue, find out what happens next week.
Right, yeah. So, like, that really confused me. Like,
right.
I was just like, what is
so
going
yeah,
on?
Like, in the next issue, like, oh, he comes out of his coma, he's all healthy now, and they have their romantic encounter or whatever.
Yeah, yeah, and Mara have space sex.
Right.
Whoa.
Yeah, which is, like,
it seemed out of character.
Well, that's where, yeah. like, all of a sudden, like, Mara is just like, oh, you know, we've got sexual tension. Let's deal
with it. Right, like, he kisses her, and she punches him. Like,
yeah.
That's not how. And then, like, then it turns rough. Okay. And then, yeah.
Yeah.
Space do it.
Yeah, that's...
And then space herpes.
Yeah, that's issue 8. That's also the issue with, like, the flashback where you see his son and his dad die.
Right.
So
that, yeah, at the beginning.
Mm-hmm. And
they go to Earth.
And then it's basically like, they're basically just like, oh, we gotta get to Earth because the feeders are all down there. Like,
right.
So, like, which is just, it starts to feel weird because the end of issue two was the feeders are going to Earth. We got to get there before them. Well, then you get all this. Then you get all this time travel stuff. Then he comes back to the present day, and then he's in prison. And then they're like, oh, the feeders are already on Earth, so now we got to go fight all the feeders. What is going on? What are the keepers? What are these keeper characters doing? Like, I took it to mean that they don't get involved with like history. Like they would gladly let Earth be destroyed if Earth was supposed to be destroyed.
Right. They're the Guardians.
They're like the Watcher.
The Watcher. That's
on Marvel Comics.
I would say Watchmen, and that's definitely not.
Not like Watchmen.
Which is fine. Like right. I don't really have a problem with that. It just like it's when starting it to feel so like, convoluted.
Yeah, like when it gets to galactic conflict like that, you're gonna be bound to have characters like that.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So then
they get to Earth.
They get to Earth, and it becomes this thing of, like...
The feeders have been there for weeks now.
Yeah, like Earth is destroyed.
So
we're even farther, like, losing concept of time.
Exactly. Right. Like, Earth has been decimated. Like, they say there's, like, a colony of survivors on the moon of, like, 10,000 people.
Right.
Like, that's it. That's like, it. Of humanity. There's, like, 10,000 humans.
And you find out, he goes down to, you know, he's got this tracker he pulls out.
Yeah.
And you assume, okay, he's going to find his wife. So his wife's still alive.
Right. Exactly. You
know, and he's going to go down there and fight, and it's this very bravado, you know, charging, you know. More getting back to, like, the first issue. Like, yeah, okay.
Exactly.
Maybe we're finally back on track.
I was about to say, issue 9... feels like it's back with, like, the first four issues.
Right. Because now he's exterminating feeders and Driznites.
Yeah, it's what we want
to
see.
He's running around killing aliens. He's trying to save women.
And it's in Houston, and it turns out, oh, he goes to the capital.
They're in Dallas.
Oh, sorry, Dallas. You find out Dallas is the new capital of the United States.
Something.
And his wife is the president.
And you're like, of course.
Yeah.
How are you going to bring a character back that is presumably dead?
You just bring her back. That's how.
Make her president.
Well, I mean, I did kind of like that joke. I think it's probably the next issue when Mara is like, oh, so that's your dead wife? And he's like, I never said she was dead. I just said I lost her.
Right.
Which is like, it almost feels like that's a line of dialogue that Rick Remender had to throw in there just to like preemptively combat anybody who was like, continuity doesn't make sense. You said it, you know.
If it's time travel, it's not going to make sense.
I don't think
anyone's going to go with the continuity issue right here on this.
Right.
Even though we might be arguing it somewhat.
We're doing it now, but no one else!
Yeah.
Everyone's going to hear this and go, why didn't I think of that?
Yeah.
I could have called him out on that.
Yeah. Well,
they're a bunch of freaking morons. No.
But yeah, I kind of started to like the series. I liked these issues more.
Back up.
When he gets to Earth and the feeders are everywhere and he's got to fight all the aliens.
Okay, it's a very, like, one man last stand.
Yeah.
He's fighting for his goal. He's fighting for the love of his life.
Yeah.
Well, like,
I interrupted.
Oh, and it's like, when they introduced the whole feeder dynamic or going to Earth, like, it felt tense. Like, it felt like there was this big thing that he needed to stop. And then when they got away from it, I'm like,
what happened to that?
Exactly. All the drama's gone.
Well,
and then they get back to it, it's like, oh, thank God, finally, you're coming back to it, okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's also, you talk about being serialized television, where the first couple episodes, they start the arc, then they do a bunch of episodes that have nothing to do with it, and then eventually at the season finale, they, aha, what you've been waiting for, and they do that.
And that's kind of what it feels like. It feels like issues one is like your introduction to the character, issue two is the introduction to your story arc, issues 3 through 8 are just sidetrack filler that have nothing to do with anything, and then issue 9 is back to the main story arc.
Right.
Which is just like...
It works, I guess, but it...
I mean, it strung us along enough to keep wanting it to get back to it.
Exactly,
right.
Yeah.
That was the thing, like, by no means did I dislike the previous issues. I had qualms with them, but in the back of my head, I just was... constantly holding
on. What about
the
whole?
Please let this come back.
Right.
Please.
Yeah.
Well, I think the Earth, you know, the feeders on Earth, also just struck more of a subconscious chord with readers. Like, they're attacking Earth. Hey, wait a minute! I live on Earth.
I should
be concerned about this.
Yeah.
Versus, you know, space yetis and robots fighting each other on a planet I don't care about.
Right.
Granted, that is super cool. Space yetis and robots fighting.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
But it doesn't touch that subconscious of.
yeah,
personal peril to me, right.
That was a cool issue. Like, right. I liked it.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, as like a single issue divergent, like it was fine, but then it just like kept going and kept going.
Part of what I really like about Heath is like, I, you know, obviously there's no way that I could possibly feel connected to him. But, you know, he did have real person problems, and that I felt connected to. So when they get away from that, I just lost that connection to him.
Right.
You know, that little bit of connection I had to him. Yeah. So when it comes back to like, oh, this is on Earth, I live on Earth, then it came back.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And, you know, and he got back to one of his primary drives, his goals.
Uh-huh.
You know,
save Earth.
Save Earth, save his wife.
Yeah. Yeah. The whole, like, I think the other thing that really bothered me about the, like, divergent, like, stories is that the whole theme of destroying Earth kept coming up. So they at first they're like, the feeders are going to go destroy Earth as it is now. The Dressites almost destroyed Earth in the past, and now they're trying to do it again.
And then the robots did it at some point also.
And right. It kind of gives this recurring thing of, like, how many times has Earth been destroyed?
Like, is this Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? Are we in the middle of a giant space highway?
Right, exactly. Yeah.
What did we do besides, well, I guess, you know, being Earthlings or Americans?
Americans, yeah.
How can anyone possibly Texans. Hate Americans?
Yeah. Texans are even better than Americans. I can say that. I'm half Texan.
Oh, is that what you were born? Half Texan.
But
it's the left half. The right half was in Oklahoma.
Oh, no.
Oh, boo.
Oklahoma? Oh. I'm sorry, Mexico? Oklahoma. I'm just kidding. Anyway.
Right, back to this book we're talking about.
So yeah, like, issue 9, him back on Earth, Earth is destroyed, killing aliens, trying to find his wife, because he's got a locator, like, a homing device, like, in, like, a pendant. The locket. It was a locket that she had of him and her, like a picture of right. him and her. And he finds the locket, and she's not wearing it. She has it just left in her office.
Right.
And so he's all like, oh, that sucks. You know, like,
right. I guess now he's got to get back tomorrow, but it implies they already left.
Yeah, they already left. And then that's when you see
the
new fear agents show up. And they're like, oh, we're fear agents. And
I kind of really didn't like that.
Really, really didn't like it, and we're gonna go ahead and talk about that right now. Talking about how, like, it. Part of the thing about this series, and the part of the reason I'm so, like, keen to talk about this and, like, talk about the things I dislike, is because what we're talking about here is when we read the early issues, we formulated, like, an idea of what we thought was going on in this world. Like, mm-hmm. We were fed information, and we had this, like, image of, like, okay, it's like this. And then at a certain point, we're fed new information, and that kind of changes the image.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, when he talks about him being the last of the fear agents, I'm like,
they even call it in, like, the top of the title. Like,
yeah, it's he's the last of the Heath Huston is... Well, actually, that's the last issue is when you change it to the not the last fear agent.
I mean, like, but, even as my first read, I felt like it was kind of a Chekhov's gun foreshadowing thing. Like, okay, mm-hmm. he's not going to be.
Yeah, it's kind of weird. Actually, I'm looking at the issue covers right now. Issue 6 and 7 have, or I'm sorry, yeah, 6 and 7 have the tag at the top of the logo where it says, Heath Huston is the last, .. fear agent.
Right.
And then issues 8 and 9, they lose that. And then in issue 10, when they introduce the new fear agents, now they have the new tag, Heath Huston is not the last, .. fear agent. Which, like, the whole not the last fear agent thing would maybe mean something if we knew anything about what the fear agents were supposed to be.
Like, that could... It felt like that should have been, like, a big reveal in, like, the third series or something.
Yeah, like, a little further down the line. Right. Yeah.
Not, what are we, issue 9 now?
Yeah, we're talking about issue 9.
9 issues of a standard comic.
Yeah. So, like, yeah, they introduce the new fear agents, and they're back. And
right.
Then in issue 10, that's where you
issue 10 wraps up everything, because issue 11 is a one-off.
Exactly. So issue 10, like, suddenly wraps everything up, sort of. Where it's like, oh, his ex-wife is president of Earth, they've got a colony on the moon, she's married to the new leader of the fear agents.
And he is super pissed for multiple reasons.
Exactly.
A, being stated that she is married to the new guy.
Yeah. I did like the joke about the new leader of the fear agents who is married to Heath's wife. His name is Keith. Yeah. And he does make a good joke where he's like, oh, his name is Keith. Like, he just married a guy that's exactly like me. Right, you know? Right. Like,
So
issue 10 is like, it just sort of like wraps everything up where they're like, yeah,
he's kill. Really upset. Like, you guys are imposters. You can't be fear agents.
Yeah.
And they're this new team that works together.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
They kind of act. Because they get surrounded and, you know, they blast off and there's more action at the beginning. But it reminded me kind of the Halo games. The first couple, you know, you're mm-hmm. Master Chief, the last Spartan, humanity's last hope, save Earth. Mm-hmm. Which, you know, again, that's powerful imagery. Then, like, Reach, Halo,
like
3.2 or whatever, mm-hmm. or the prequel to blah, whatever. There's a whole team of them and they all work together, but they all wind up dying. But it whenever you introduce more after you've already established the last, I feel like it's kind of a sellout.
Yeah,
especially like Doctor Who, they did as well. Oh, he's the last, you know, Time Lord. But he's not! Dun, dun, dun!
Dragon Ball Z did it, too.
Yeah.
Goku's the last Saiyan, blah, blah, blah. But no, he's not.
Right.
Well, I mean, that's even a Star Wars thing. Boba Fett was like the... At one point,
don't get me started.
At one point, he was the last of the Mandalorians, right?
Right. Well, that's why he's got the armor. Or he was the best one. He's killed them all.
Or maybe he just killed them all and took their armor. I don't know. Then I guess he's like some kind of like baby clone idiot of some other guy. I don't know.
The fact that you had to add the idiot on the end of that is what killed me.
He got killed by a blind man on accident. Boba Fett's an idiot. And that's in the original series,
right?
Not the prequels.
Right.
So, there you go. And Jango Fett didn't get killed in too heroic of a way either. He just got his head chopped off. He walked
into a lightsaber.
He just walked into it. But that's where the Star Wars discussion is going to end for now. So...
Yeah, I don't think any of us want to open that.
We're not. So, yeah, like, this issue, like, it's just sort of them on the moon, and you get the character drama of Heath and his ex-wife, and they're all like, we've got a plan to kill the feeders. We need to go to the feeders' home planet and find their natural enemy and bring it to Earth, and they'll just wipe out the feeders.
Right, right.
Okay.
Heath says...
Heath even is like, that's a terrible plan.
Right, right. Like, any normal person would agree with Heath. Like, yeah. Giant tentacle monster that eats, consumes everything. Let's get the thing that eats that and introduce that. It'll be our friend.
Exactly.
No.
So, yeah.
And there's
so,
also that drama with Mara because she's there. Cause
well, that's the big...
She's all upset because, you know, he
cared about his ex-wife. He, like, left them to go rescue her on the planet.
Just like you said earlier, it's the,
she becomes Jilted Lover.
Thank you, yeah.
Yeah.
Lover.
Yeah. Because they have, like, one... love scene, and then...
uncomfortable love scene, but it's there.
Yeah. And then they're... So, like, they talk about their plan, and then they're like, oh, you know, you're the original fear agent, you're, like, a legend around here.
Right.
We want you to be, like, the constable of the space station to keep everything in line while
we
go do this. Right,
because we're too busy acting like heroes, so we need you to police the bums.
Yeah, exactly. And it's just... He's just like, whatever, I'm an alcoholic. I have nothing. I guess I'm going to do it. Whatever.
Right. Like, at that point, I lost...
The momentum was, like, totally gone for
me. Deflated. Well, they took away... Earth is destroyed.
Yeah.
He's no longer fighting for his wife.
Yeah.
He's lost everything. I mean, he's died, everything. Like...
Right.
There's nowhere left to go. And he even says, well, just give me enough food and fuel... I'll get out of here.
Yeah, I think that's the thing that confused me, like, at this point. I couldn't figure out why he was hanging around.
Right.
And why wasn't he just like, oh, my ex-wife, I came back to rescue you, and obviously you didn't need rescuing because you got a new husband, and you got your shit together, and I'm a hopeless wreck. Why the fuck am I even here? I'm just gonna leave.
Right. Like, they don't even have it out in, like, that conversation.
Yeah.
It's just classic non-communication drama.
Yeah,
which,
yeah.
If the characters would at least talk to each other,
they would have just said,
like, normal adults, right. They even had a yelling fest, they would have got half those issues resolved, and, like, well, why were you showing up there in the first place?
Yeah.
Like, I came to save your ass, but clearly I don't need to do that, and storm off.
Exactly.
But he just goes, he doesn't say anything. It's like, oh, for the bounty on the Dresden.
Yeah, I don't want you to know that I care about you.
Right. It's, the hell? You just...
yeah.
Fought half a planet of these...
Yeah, by that point, if I fought half a planet, I would go, I don't care about you. I do still care about you.
Right.
You
know? Exactly.
Like, I don't care that you're in the equation here.
Yeah, so it just feels like weird. Like, I couldn't... They were like, oh, we'll set you up in your old bunk and you can just hang out here for a while. I just couldn't understand why he was still doing it. Like, what...
It was kind of like end of Hitchhiker's, like, oh, Earth's been destroyed. We're the last humans. We need to stick together type of thing.
Yeah, they were also kind of sticking the whole, like, I think they mention it in this. Like,
well, at least there's enough of us to repopulate.
Well, they were also kind of sticking him with, he's got a little bit of guilt over Earth being destroyed the first time because, like, I don't remember if they talk about it in this issue.
I think it's the last one. Are you with the Russian? I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. They talk about how he, like, abandoned Fear Agents the first time, and that's why, you know.
He's all upset about the new Fear Agents, and they're like, well, you can't, you know.
You have no right to be upset. You abandoned Earth.
Right.
Know? And it's just like, okay, so then I guess some other weird stuff happened at some point, like.
Which we're not told of.
Yeah, we do find out about it in the Dark Horse series. But in this issue, what we're talking about, you don't find out. And it's just like, so it just kind of feels like, I don't know, I thought it was weird. I just, like, it started to feel like, this, again, going back to the whole, like, TV writing, it started to feel like these characters were not acting like real people, and they were just saying whatever they needed to say to ensure whatever drama needed to exist to finish, like, the emotional story.
Right.
And that was my... That's such a huge criticism I have for Lost. Like, none of the people act like real people. They all talk in riddles, because that way nobody knows what's going on. When any sane person would just be like, I'm doing this!
That's a goddamn bear!
Exactly, yeah. No, but they all talk in, like, flipping mystery riddles, because...
That's what I love so much about the first issue, because, I mean, we haven't talked about how much we love that enough.
Seriously, yeah.
Whenever he was, like, narrating to us and, like, talking in his mind, just trying to, like, work his way through it, it felt real. He was just like,
it was all
damn, I need a drink.
Yeah.
That's all he was thinking. Like, I need to get out of here so I can get a drink.
Yeah.
Well, like, I took this job having promised my ship AI I do try to do the sober. And he was failing because he wasn't drunk enough.
That was, it, like, felt real.
Right.
Yeah. I liked that. Yeah. Yeah. By issue 10, it feels different. Like, it does not feel like issue 1
totally
at
different.
All.
And even the cherry on top of it, at the last page
and then, the big
of issue 11, is you see this communication from the Dresdenite saying, thank you for allowing us to destroy Earth. And, you know, he's like, and you find out he's talking to Maria. She's like,
Mara,
as long as you hold up your end of the bargain.
Yeah, and she's like rubbing her hands and cackling like an evil villain.
Right, no.
And I was just like, what? Is that supposed to be like a plot twist or a red herring? I don't even care at this point.
No. Gratuitous plot twists that just don't fit.
And that's why we were saying, like, I just can't get a bead on what this character's supposed to be, because she changes in every issue.
I mean, if they were making her change so we couldn't get a bead on her, more power to them. Yeah. But that still feels, like, gimmicky.
Well, if it feels like that character's only purpose there is, it's not, like you said,
plot twist.
It's not actually a character, it's whatever they need her to be at that time.
Yeah.
They do that a lot with certain characters in different movies and whatnot.
Yeah,
which
exactly.
Which is unfortunate, because I really liked how she started.
She
was great.
Yeah.
She could have been the audience's connection.
Yeah.
She doesn't know what's going on. You know, we're following Houston, he's the main character, but we can see everything through a naive character.
Yeah, Heath explains it to Mara.
She's the point of view character.
Right.
Yeah, Heath explains it to Mara, and then... By proxy, we learn it.
Uh-huh. And we learn about Heath through Mara learning about Heath.
And that's a clever way to fill the reader in without just blatantly saying, this is what's going on.
Right. Exactly. And that's, there were like bits of that here and there. Like,
right.
Because like, whenever she was there to fill that purpose, that's what she did.
Right.
But like, she wasn't always there. And
whenever,
like,
she wasn't dead or...
Whenever she wasn't...
She wanted hot money sex or whatever.
You know what? You're right.
I got that.
She says hot money sex, and I couldn't tell if that was a typo. Was it supposed to be monkey sex?
That's what I read that too. I'm like,
yeah.
Hot money sex? I'm sure that's supposed to be hot monkey sex.
Right? I did think that was funny, though.
Because she said that when she was on trial.
Yeah.
You know,
with the truth telling thing.
Yeah.
And she's like,
and what do you feel about, you know, Heath Huston? Like,
yeah.
I think he's low down, you know. Good for
He's like a scum deserter, but I want to have hot money sex with him.
Right.
And I was like, is that supposed to be monkey sex? Because if not, I love hot money sex.
New band name.
Hot money sex. Oh, yeah. You got that one, yes. Luke.
The meat sweats of hot money sex. best ones.
Maybe they shouldn't play together.
No. Oh. So yeah, the issue 10 ends with that sort of like it, like everything's sort of wrapped up, and
the Bowfinger, you know, or a Bond.
Yeah, there's like this cliffhanger of like, oh, I guess Mara's kind of a bad guy, but I don't really know where this is going. And then they sort of have a plan of like, you know where the story is sort of going, because they're like, we got to go get this
new Predator.
Yeah. It's weird. It feels like there's not a solid direction.
No.
That's what it is. Like, it feels like it's all over the place, and there's no, like, I have no idea where the story is supposed to be going and what it's supposed to be doing.
That's why I also thought, that, you know, it feels like they've wrapped up, they shoved all of their story ideas into those 10 issues.
Yeah. Because
they weren't sure they were going to continue.
Right. And then issue 11 is just a standalone story.
It's a
one-shot. Just a one-off of him on a job, and he gets into some trouble, and then he survives.
Yeah.
And, like, that. I mean, I did like that issue. Yeah. Did you like it?
I thought it was okay.
Yeah.
At this point, I was kind of
burned out. At this point, you're kind of checked out of
right.
the book. Right.
I'm checked out. It was... I saw issue 11 as one of those things in the back.
Uh-huh.
About just... It's kind of one-off. I want to know what's going on in the main story. This would have been okay
yeah.
if he talked about it, or, you know, a nice couple fillers had they wrapped up everything, which I kind of see them doing that. But I think they took too many liberties, because you're not sure when this happens.
Right.
So if this was, like, you know, before, or, you know, this is after, when is this? It's just him going to this bug planet, agrees to take a job to kill a cave full of spiders. He's like... You didn't say it was a cave full of spiders, giant spiders. Fuck that. And he blows all their money on booze, whores, and
yeah.
apparently, you know, food.
Yeah.
Which turns out to be...
Spider eggs.
Spider eggs.
which I thought was a funny joke.
Right.
It's like eating all these berries, and it's like they're actually spider eggs, so they all hatch in his stomach, and spiders just start frothing out of his mouth.
Right.
No, I mean, it's a good story. It takes place in the past. It takes place in that 10-year period between whatever happened on Earth.
Like, it was his first job, or like...
It was just a random job.
Because the planet was the closest from Earth.
Oh, yeah, you know what? It might have been something.
So I thought it implied like this was like... You know,
maybe an early job that he took, yeah. I mean, I liked it. It was just such weird timing, as you said. Because like, we'd just gone through... This, like, 10-issue series that was really, like, kind of all over the place and, like, lost its momentum. And, like, I don't know, like, where it's going and what's going to happen. And then you just kind of, like, tack on this, like, one-off adventure story that's, like, I like it as an individual story. But, again, we're talking about reading this, like, month to month. It just felt so just, like, this anticlimactic, pointless, like, why am I even trying?
Everything happened last episode... You want it to continue, and
you want to follow the momentum.
It had been doing that up until this point.
Exactly.
And now, you know, like, what's Mara? And then you get the story about Wild West bugs and spiders. Yeah. Like, do I have to wait another month? And it turns out, you gotta wait longer, because it's now this whole new miniseries.
I just was about to say that. Like, the Mara reveal, albeit very confusing, it was big. You know?
Yeah.
We want answers to that. And then they're like, nope, side story.
Yeah. It's so, like, I like it as an individual story, but as I said, it was weird in that sort of monthly momentum place, and I don't know what was going on behind the scenes. Like, at the end of issue 11, Rick Remender made a big, like, he wrote a big afterword, basically saying, like, the reasons are purely business reasons, you know, no hard feelings among everybody,
right.
Like, I like Image, I like Dark Horse, we're just moving to Dark Horse, that's just the way things are. And I mean, I certainly don't expect him to
justify to you.
Well, he certainly doesn't need to justify to me, right. Just a reader. But he also does, you know, I don't expect him to air any dirty laundry. Even if there was something going on behind the scenes, I wouldn't expect him to talk about it. That's not
especially
professional.
At
hot
the end
money
of the
sex.
Book. Not really sex. Yeah, like if he's going to air it, like especially not at the end of the book.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's he's a professional, so whatever. Yeah. You know, I mean, I was fine with that. Like, I don't really need the gossip of
right. To me, it seemed like we're contracted for 11, or contracted for 10. We get one more before we, switch publishers.
Yeah,
let's just take one of these old stories, or these and just small stories fill at the back
for a whole full
and
issue.
And fill it for a full issue.
Yeah, I don't, like I said, I don't really know, or I don't really care about like why they switched. All I care about is the story. Right. And so like that's why in talking about the story, like I really like this comic, but I'm also, as anybody who's been listening to this podcast for the last hour and a half knows that like I'm really frustrated by this comic.
Yeah, yeah.
Part of it's so frustrating because the first issue made me go, man, this potentially could be so astounding.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
And it just kind of faltered.
Well, and it feels
faltered
like...
Faltered is not the right word. It just...
Well, it like as we said, it just sort of like becomes something different. Right. It feels like the setup is so good for... like, we were talking about it feeling like written by like TV, like TV writing. The funny thing is, it does feel like a perfect setup for a Monster of the Week style of TV writing. Where it's just like... every story, he gets a new job to go like exterminate some aliens, and then shenanigans happen.
Right.
We learn a little bit about his past, and then he moves on to the next job.
There's something to be right. There's something to be said for just a simple story. You can have that big overarching story about, you know, maybe, you know, slowly reveal the fear agents and what happens to them over all these jobs of him just, you know, taking out the Western, you know, bug spiders, or, you know, tracking down this one alien and turns out to be this gangster or whatever, you know, mix it up. But sometimes just that simple story can speak volumes. Like, the movie Dread is amazing. It's a very simple story, though.
Right, yeah.
You know,
anybody who listens to our podcast knows how Luke and I feel about
that. Right, right, right. You know, you don't have to do the Shyamalan, J.J. Abrams, super twist tangle, bet you never saw that hook coming, but you've done it so much before, we did, and
it loses the effect.
It loses the effect.
It lost the effect the first time, frankly, but it continues to lose the effect every time we do it.
Right.
Yeah, this is definitely a series that I don't think, I mean, obviously, I don't think it lived up to the potential of the first issue, because I would say
even the first four.
The first four, yeah, because like honestly, as I'm repeating myself here, but like as we said, like it started off like it was going to be a Monster of the Week kind of thing. Like even the first four issues where he travels back in time, that felt like, oh, I'm going to do this mission. Things get a little crazy, then we're going to wrap it up, and then we're going to go on to the mission.
Right.
But if
four had gone straight to nine,
yeah,
and taken out the whole. Keeper, space jail.
Yeah, all that time travel stuff. If he had just, like, gone back to the present, and he's like, well, I'm glad we're done with that adventure, now I gotta go save Earth.
I think that would have made it...
Would have made it a lot better, I think. Yeah. It... Yeah, I think... I think that's my big problem with that. I do think that when they switched to Dark Horse, they did try to get back to that whole, like... contained stories, right. And like,
do you think they just did too much to really be able to get back to it comfortably?
Well, I think at that point the series was a little beyond my expectations.
Yeah,
because this was that problem with like all these like plot reveals and like all these different plot twists and everything. So issue 10 ends with Mara being like, yes, I let you do your thing.
Off of me, Jocko.
Yeah. Her whole thing is like, I don't even care what you do as long as you fulfill your end of the bargain. Who knows what her, you know, the bargain is? Who knows? And then issue 11 is a standalone story, fine. And then the next five issues is a miniseries it's a miniseries telling the origin of the Fear Agents. So it's like a full, I'd have to actually check the publication dates, but it's like forever till we get any follow-up of what was going on with this plot twist about Mara, because the next Dark Horse series doesn't have anything to do with that, because it's all flashback to when the Dressites and the Totality and the robot aliens invaded Earth and started killing everybody, and they tell that whole story, and he tells the story of Heath Huston becoming forming the Fear Agents, and why he left, why he's the last. It's the story of why he's the last Fear Agent. Like, it's not a bad story in and of itself, but it just like feels so weird and out of place in this monthly momentum comic. Like, they set up in the Image series, they set up this like constant cliffhanger plot twist, stringing you along, red herring, and then it just like slams on full stop on these breaks, and it's like, now here's a flashback that has nothing to do with
anything. Here's an actual story.
Here's an actual story, which I was like, okay, I'm glad for an actual story, but it does not jive with what was going on before.
Right. As I mentioned before, but I actually stopped buying halfway through that, because I think I was just... I wanted to know what happened, and I was just like, eh.
Well, as I said...
I understand why I stopped buying... Having gone back and reread...
Reread these issues.
The issues. I understand why I stopped buying it. Because, you know, taste change, and I was...
Yeah.
I was done with it. I didn't want any more... Kind of not madness, but
yeah.
It wasn't. It turned out what's
it just really wasn't delivering what you wanted.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, and like the Dark Horse, the first Dark Horse issues where they tell the origin of the Fear Agents, that bothered me because it continued with the whole like set in present day kind of a thing, because that's where they really drive home like it's okay. So it's. That's where you really get the whole, like, oh, this isn't taking place in the far future. Like, it's, like, present day when the aliens attack. And the story, it does still play, like, with the homage to, like, the classic EC stuff. Like, there's actually a lot of homages specifically to Mars Attacks, which is something that Wally Wood did a lot of the designs and art for. So, I do think that it's still in keeping with the...
Certainly,
it's keeping with the style. And, like, maybe, probably even the original ideas. But it just felt... A little, like, again, it just didn't jive with, like, the vibe I was getting from the first issues. Right. Like, the story that I was creating in my head as a reader about, like, what to expect, it just went in a different direction.
It might be very interesting if those of you living out there, listening out there in Comic Land, if you read that Dark Horse first one-off before if you read that first before you read anything else,
yeah.
You want to try it? Let us know what you think somehow.
Leave a comment on the website.
There you go.
Like, it actually would... Thinking about this series, I almost wonder if it that would play big, better if they just did the first story.
Me, as a first-time reader, I'm going to try and see if I can, like, gather what you're saying. Mm-hmm. But part of me also wishes I would have done that as well.
But at the same time... Like, this first issue is so great.
Right.
Of just him, like, rocking around in space, drinking whiskey, shooting aliens.
And it just didn't...
It's really good. I really wanted more of that. I really wanted more of that.
I think part of me wants to say they thought that the reader was going to want something different from it and not that original aesthetic.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's... Yeah, that I think that is what happened. As a reader... Yeah. I really wanted something different than what the book became.
Yeah. It was just a bunch of fluff that, to be honest, I didn't really care about.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I wanted the badass Texan testosterone-filled action flick comic.
Mm-hmm.
But we only got two issues of it.
Right. It kind of, it like, flirted in and out with that. Yeah. So, I think we've pretty much said
final
as
thoughts.
Much we can say. Yeah, final thoughts. Josh, there's maybe about 20 issues left after these 11 issues. Do you feel like going through and finishing the series?
Part of me does, just to get that closure.
Yes.
Having gone back and reread it, just to figure out, you know, did it continue? What the hell happened with everything?
Mm-hmm.
But with these first 11, you know, I really like it. Part of them are so good. And part of it is so poor.
Yeah.
I don't want to say bad, but it's just...
It's just like, messy. As we said, it's just like conflicting.
It reminds me of Star Wars, honestly.
Yeah.
Part of them are so good, like the originals. And part of them is so bad, like the prequels.
The prequels, yeah.
And you can try to take what you like, but in the end, you're stuck.
You're stuck with
the whole story.
Yeah.
For good or worse.
Yeah. I mean, I'm kind of the same way. I never did finish the series. I think there may be 10 issues.
You got farther in.
I did get farther than you. I do kind of feel like, now that I've just like read all these 11 in one sitting, I do kind of feel like just like burning through the rest of it just to get that closure.
Yeah,
exactly. Like,
what the hell happened?
Yeah, I just want to know where he goes with it. But
was Mara a bad guy? Will Heath leave?
Exactly.
Will the new aliens like them? Find out next time.
Yeah, I wonder if I'll ever get around to it because I'm a huge procrastinator.
What?
I know. This is news to nobody. But
yeah,
but yeah, Luke. Final thoughts.
Part of me really does want to read the rest of them, almost for pretty much the same
reasons
we
said.
Yeah, but like, I wouldn't say that I feel obligated because while I didn't get what I wanted out of the series, I got
kind of, like, I felt satisfied enough, you know?
Yeah.
None of the things that we had qualms with were bad enough to make me go, I don't really want to read this anymore.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, if it was that bad, I would have put it down and not have kept reading. Yeah. Like, no. At this point, you know, I did put it down at some point, but, like, I was on board with it, like, through these
issues.
The
stuff that was good enough, or not good enough, the stuff that was so good still has that carrot in front of my face, stringing me along, yeah. Making me go, maybe it gets back to it.
Well, as we said, maybe. As we said, Heath is a cool character.
Yes,
so I totally am down for reading more comics about this character. He's a cool guy. I like mm-hmm. him. He's a good main character.
Yeah, and it's like, while the convoluted stuff still, the focus was about him,
mm-hmm.
it also still kind of wasn't. Like, it was right. It was a focus. Well, the stuff that was bad was a focus on an aspect of his character that I didn't care about.
Right.
The
right.
whole cloning concept, blah, 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 blah. But yeah, I liked it enough. Mm-hmm. It was good. It was still good.
Yeah, there is a trade paperback, I think, where they collected the tales of the Fear Agent, all the little short stories, mm-hmm. and then also some other, like, they did a one-off, like a one-shot at Dark Horse of just like, here's just a like issue 11 of this. So it's just like an old random story of him going on an adventure. They did collect that into a trade paperback, I think, called just Tales of the Fear Agent.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be curious to read that and see if that kind of delivers more of the, like, what I wanted out of this book, which was just Heath Huston.
The first couple issues.
Yeah, Heath Huston just rocking around the galaxy.
Testosterone-filled action flick.
Fighting aliens and, yeah.
Fighting round the world.
Fighting round the world. But the thing is, too, you know, We're harping on about this a lot. It's not that I'm opposed to, like, starting off with, like, a simple story and then having it open into, like, a larger, longer, like, series. Like, I'm really not opposed to that.
I just think they did that too quickly.
I just think it just, like, got really weird and it didn't really follow, like, the same style, and it just wasn't that clear, and it just, I mean, you know, to repeat myself, it just kind of got off the rails. Like, the story got away from him.
Yeah.
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 So that is,
first 11 issues of Fear Agent.
Yeah, the first 11 issues of Fear Agent, and that was a very,
first 11 issues in, what, 2 hours?
Yeah.
A lot happens.
Almost 2 hours, yeah. We've been recording for an hour and 45 minutes.
It's worth noting that the one we were the most critical about was the longest one.
Exactly.
This is the longest one by a long
time. You know, this is the longest one, and it is definitely the most critical we've ever been out of a book. And that's only,
I'd say the only follow-up would be Gabe's for,
Gabe's criticisms of Rex Liebers, which I do think were cogent points to make. But yeah, so we're only critical because we're just so passionate about it.
Passionate about what it could have been.
Yep.
And so just half the internet.
Yeah. So I think that's gonna do it for us on Fear Agent. Thank you, everybody, for sitting through this whole podcast, if you're still listening. Thank you for listening. I, of course, am Aaron Walther. You can find me on Facebook. I'm on Twitter at AAWALTHER. That's AA Walther on Twitter. You can also find comics that I have written and read on my website, AaronWalther.com, and also on NewHavenComics.com. Luke?
As always, you can find me on Facebook at Luke Moritz and on Twitter at Luke T. Moritz. And you can find new episodes of the podcast at comicdna.podbean.com and also now on iTunes.
That is correct. Josh, did you have any contact information you want to put out there?
You can find me around.
Yeah.
I'm not really into social media.
That's no problem.
You can find some of the stuff I wrote on newhavencomics.com
or
the new Comixology. Check out Time Agent Z if you like Fear Agent.
That's a good plug.
Fear Agent, less maybe sci-fi, a little bit more history.
Yeah.
But enjoy.
It is history, science fiction.
Yes.
Yeah, so...
Shameless plug.
Shameless plug. Hey, those are the best kind of plugs. Those are the only kind of plugs, really.
If anyone's listening by this point of the podcast, they're okay with plugs.
Yeah. Come back for the next episode.
We are going to be reading Peepo Chew by Felipe Smith. This is going to be our first manga that we've ever done for this episode. And it's an interesting manga because it's by an American who moved to Japan to draw a Japanese manga. And it's a comic that is about the culture clash between Japan and America. So it's going to be a really, really great episode. We're going to have two guests on that episode. John Parrish is going to be coming back to talk to us about Pibuchu, and we are also going to have Luke's friend Joe, who both Joey and John have both spent time actually living in Japan. So we're going to get their perspective on this book that is about the culture clash between Japan and America. So it's going to be a really great episode, and I'm really excited to do it. So thank you, everybody, for listening, and we'll see y'all next time.